Dear friends, welcome to Thalir. It means bud. It is budding forth to a new life. And we are Capuchins working for the renewal of the society and the church.
Dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, on behalf of Thalir Capuchin Online Ministries, I welcome you for this week's special program meant for social work directors. This is from Thalir Visit, the virtual institute for spirituality, integrity, and transformation. We shall be dealing with project management and fundraising in this week. This is from part of the International Skills Development Program meant for the social work directors. This is from 16th to 20th of November, every day evening 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Indian time. On the 16th, we shall have the special session on the rights-based approach to development by Dr. Arul Kamaraj and Reverend Father Jyoti, a Jesuit priest. On the 17th and 18th, we shall have the sessions on project management and fundraising by Mr. Prabhakar. On the 19th, we shall have a special session on Foreign Contribution Regulation Act on the recent development by Dr. Kandasamy, the Audit and Finance Manager. On the 20th, we shall have a special session on the Catholic Social Teaching and the Marginalized by Dr. Prakash Louis, a Jesuit missionary. Welcome to Thalir Capuchin Online Ministries.
A very good evening to one and all present here. Good afternoon and good morning to some countries. Success is the sum of efforts. We, the social workers, we need to do it day by day. Then only we can accomplish our task. Welcome to International Program on Project Management. Before to proceed my presentation, let me ask a few questions to all the delegates. I request everyone, please type the answer in the chat box. I request all the participants, please write the answer in the chat box. The first question: what are the three things needed to start a travel business? What are the three important things needed to start a travel business? I request all the participants, please use your chat box. Very good. Feasibility planning. Okay. Okay. Finance, passport. Okay. Visa. Okay. Finance, vehicle. Okay. Money. Good. Registration. Okay. Okay, organization, okay, finance, money, vehicle, okay, visa, license, okay, creative, okay, travel business, okay, language, knowledge, accommodation, planning, okay, good, vehicle, okay, money, finance, okay, plan, target, money, employees, knowledge, very good, very good. I appreciate your answer. Good, good, good. Good driver, very good. Good driver, okay. Good vehicle, okay. 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 Feasibility, okay. Okay. Capital, okay. Competent, okay. Good. Finance, knowledge, drivers, vehicles, security, okay. Communication skill, okay. Vision, influence. Very good, very good, very good. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much. Thank you for your answer. Very detailed answer. Desire, okay. Okay, good, good. GPRS, link, network. Okay. Mind, body, spirit. Very good. Okay, desire, goal, vision. Good, good. Many of you are saying money, vehicle, fitness. Good, excellent, excellent. Let me ask the next question. What are the three things needed to start a supermarket business? Partners, okay. What are the three things needed to start a supermarket business? Money, distinctions, okay. Place, building, very good. Building, okay. Public, creative idea, very good. Money, okay. Planning, money. Infrastructure, good. Building, finance, money, structure, building. Legal matters, good. Money and okay. Vision, employees, planning, good. Presentation, okay. Finance, idea, consumers, good. Planning, good. Good answer. Knowledge and business capital, very good. Budget, marketing, money, shareholders, human resources, planning, good. Very good, very good. I appreciate all your answer. Excellent, excellent answer. Okay, last question. What are the three things needed to start a hotel business? Thank you. We'll move to the next question. What are the three things needed to start a hotel business? Money, okay. Good manager, good cook, knowledge, very good. Land, okay. Building, chef, okay. Place, okay. Finance, knowledge, oh, money, place. Money, good employee, manager, networking, infrastructure, website, customers, place, building, excellent, excellent answer. Good strategy, okay. PRO, planning, kitchen, very good. Kitchen, good catering, okay. Money, good workers, skilled person, excellent, excellent. Skill, oh, hotel rate, okay. Good storage capacity, very good. Cleanliness, competency, ventilation, good relationship, very good, excellent, excellent, excellent. Thank you so much. Involvement, okay, vision, involvement. Thank you so much for your immediate response to all the three questions. Just to see the travel business. These are the travel companies running their travel business without any drivers or without any vehicles. Majority of you have mentioned that we need vehicle, we need driver, we need infrastructure, we need building. But without driver, without vehicle, they are running a travel business. How it is possible? We'll move into the next answer. I asked the questions to start a supermarket business. You said infrastructure, worker, employees, building, storage, all the things. But they are doing a supermarket business without infrastructure, without employees. How it is possible? I asked the third question. To start a hotel business, we know number of hotel business, Make My Trip, Trivago. This is even with one website, they can do any business. You said good cook, chef, employees, infrastructure. But Make My Trip or Trivago, they don't have any single hotel, but they are doing a hotel business. We are in the modern world. The whole world is changing. We are in the globalized world. Some innovative idea, some innovative, creative ideas in the digital world is possible to run a business. Yes, when you want to have a business in the global market, we must have innovative business idea. Little investment, need not capital investment, little investment. Good technology and the marketing. The same time, even if you don't want any infrastructure, we don't want big capital investment, we don't want human resources, but if you identify the research problem, you can do a project. Only thing is, you have to find out the feasibility of your research project. And you can do any research project with minimum resources. We have seen three business with minimum resources, they can do a wonder in their business. Even in your research project, with minimum resources, you can do wonder in your research project. Another important thing is the outcome or the research. The research is very, very important. It should help to the society to solve the problem of the society. Yes, we are in the digital world. We are in the real evolution. We know the human evolution started from stone period to digital period. In this period, as we, the individuals and the entire communities of people, are systematically blocked from three important areas. One is rights. The rights are denied to the people. They are not giving the rights to the people. The constitution has given the rights to all the people, but the majority or dominant of the society is denying the rights to the people. Second important element of the problem is denial of opportunities. Every individual citizen of the country can utilize the opportunity for the development, but the opportunities are denied. Third important thing is the resources. The country, the whole world, the whole earth has provided a lot of resources to utilize it, but people are denying the resources to the people. Yes, this is the human right violations in the whole world. We are in incredible world. Rice is rupees 40 per kg, but SIM card is free. Pizza reaches home faster than police and the ambulance. Car loan is charged at a 5% interest, but education loan is charged at 12% interest. We are living in incredible world. Education is in the hands of private, but wine shop is in the hands of the government. We are living in incredible world. Footwears are sold in AC room, but the vegetables are sold on the footpath. We are living in incredible world. We have time to update our status in social media, but we don't have time to improve the status of the poor as well as the marginalized in the society. We worship goddess, but abuse women. We have constructed mega malls, but the country is forcefully evicting the poor from the slum areas. We are living in an incredible world. The politicians are dining in marginalized houses, but the same politicians are killing them for their right to eat what they want to eat. We are living in incredible world. This is nothing but a human rights violation. The actions by state actors abuse, ignore, or deny a basic rights. The basic rights including a social rights, economic rights, civil rights, political rights, and a cultural rights. Each and every citizens are denying this. As we, the social worker, we have to raise our voice against these human rights violations. The father of Constitution of India, Baba Saheb Dr. Ambedkar, said, "Life should be great rather than long." Yes, this is our role to play in the society. In the country, the society, the people are marginalized in terms of opportunities. Their capacity is not properly utilized, and sometimes they are exploited by the dominant people in the society. And they cannot access the resources available in the society, even by the government. And there is no security for their life. People are marginalized. people are oppressed and they are considered as Dalits or scheduled caste or scheduled tribe. Yes, we have seen the whole world. People are discriminated in terms of ethnicity. You have seen ethnic-based discriminations all over the world. And caste-based discriminations. This is very common in India. Religion-based discrimination. This is also prevails all over the world. Sexual orientations, male, female, transgender. Still, we have a stigma. In terms of migrant status, people are excluded from the society. And we the social worker, we have to include them. The concept of social inclusion is to make them a part of the mainstream society. Sometimes they are rejecting someone from the interpersonal interaction. They cannot easily move with the people in the society and they are oppressed. The relational aggression or a social aggression is prevails in the society. And these marginalized people should be empowered through a social work intervention. The discrimination in terms of various forms. One is a public institutions. Yes, the marginalized people cannot access the public institutions like education institutions or public areas or temple. And even education discrimination also common in most of the countries. And the oppressed, the marginalized people are not given education and they cannot study in some of the rural area also. And they cannot access health services also. And their legal systems are denied. And they cannot enter into their place of worship. Still in India, some of the places, some of the villages, and Dalits or marginalized people, they cannot enter into any temple. Sometimes the social institutions like the household are discriminated. Even in India, if they are belong to scheduled caste or scheduled tribes, they are household is discriminated by the dominant people in the village. They are living in the outskirts of the particular village. This is the one form of a discrimination. When we talk about the human rights based approach, yes, it is a conceptual framework for the process of human development. That is normatively based on international human rights standards. And how to direct it to promoting and protecting the human rights. It seeks to analyze the inequalities which lie at the heart of a development problem and redress discrimination practices and unjust distribution of power that impede development progress. As we talk about the human rights, the rights which are inherent in our nature and without which human rights, we cannot live as a human being. If you are a human being, you have to enjoy your basic and fundamental rights. The human rights and the fundamental rights allows us to fully develop and use our human qualities, intelligence, talents, and concerns, and to satisfy the spiritual and other needs also. The human rights and the development are at crossroads. Especially in India, after 70 years of independence, still the rights are denied to some section of the people in the country. Yes, we the social worker, we have greater role to think about the peace, the equality, the dignity, hope, love, education, prosperity, justice, food and religion of the people. If you try to maintain all these things, yes, the individual citizen can enjoy his rights. The human rights based approach, yes, it always focus on process and outcome. Sometimes it emphasizes the realizing the rights. It has to realize the rights of the person. At the same time, we have to recognize the individual as well as the group. For example, if a marginalized people in the society means their individuals are entitled to assistance. They may be focused on structural causes and their manifestation. There are four important areas in human rights-based approach. First one is, we have to focus on the vulnerable groups, including issues of gender and discrimination. In the country, in the whole world, we are talking about gender-based discrimination. The word of gender sensitivity is popular in the world. Because if gender-based discrimination occurs, the society cannot develop. Second important focus is the root cause of poverty, deprivation, and human rights violations. So this is a common all over the world. Still, people are living in below poverty line. Even most of the countries, their income is less than $1. Another important focus of human rights based approach is the relationship between rights holders and the duty bearers. Sometimes the duty bearers will not implement the laws, the legislations properly in the society. And the culprits, they may escape from the loopholes when they are doing a human rights violation in the country. The fourth important aspect of the human rights-based approach is focus on empowerment. When we are giving these human rights, equal rights to every individual, the empowerment is possible to a common people. There are a number of values added to the development related to the human rights-based approach. The first one is the rights. Second one is the holistic view. The holistic view in terms of the overall development of every individual citizen. The international instruments, yes, we have international agencies and international guidelines. Whether we are following this international guidance is a big question mark in all over the world. The participatory process, whether people are given opportunity to participate any decision making in the society as well as in the country. Another important problem is the value is the transparency and accountability. Majority of the problem related to the politics as well as the administration is because lack of transparency and accountability. We have to ensure the transparency and accountability. Another important thing is we need to monitor the whole progress and to know the effectiveness of the implementation of the human rights in the society. The last one is the sustained results. Yes, the whole human rights violations is denial of a sustainable development of the individual. As we have to focus the sustained development of the people. We need to resolve the conflict of the people if there is a human rights violation. We have to involve different stakeholders for the development. One person cannot make a lot of changes in the country, but if we work together, definitely we can make a lot of transformations. Another important thing is by undertaking a social impact assessment and risk analysis. When we want to resolve any problems or conflicts, we need to do an impact assessment and also a risk analysis. Third important thing is education and redress mechanism can be set up as part of development project. So our projects should give social, to make a social change, and that should be a mechanism to lead to the social change. And by encouraging alternative law groups, we have to implement properly the law properly. At the same time, we have to create a lot of enforcement law if necessary. There are a number of sustainability challenges: the population growth, extreme poverty and inequality, financial and economic crisis, food crisis, climate change, water scarcity, energy and security, and migration. As we know very well, these are a common problem in all the developing countries. Most important, the human rights violation is the caste-based violations in India. Four varnas: one is Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and Sudras, and one more, the untouchables, that they are called as the Panjamas. The Panjamas and Sudras are always oppressed by the Brahmins, Kshatriyas, and Vaishyas. The caste-based violations is very common in India. So this leads to a rigid social system. The people, the marginalized people, they are facing many problems. They are forcing to work more than the working hours, the heavy workload. And they are not giving a proper salary or wages what they work in the landlords. And lack of maternity benefits to especially a marginalized women. And they are facing many problems, both physical and mental problems. And unemployment is very common among the marginalized people. The dominant community people, they have land, they can just involve in the agriculture, and they have resources and they can do the business. But the marginalized youth, they are facing unemployment problems in the country. And most probably they are not at all aware of the basic rights of the citizen among the marginalized. And they are facing more exploitation. All their resources are exploited by the dominant community in the country. These are some of the common problems in India. Two-tumbler system or twin-tumbler system. Even in most of the villages in India, especially in Tamil Nadu area, still we have a discrimination in terms of two-tumbler system in tea shop. If the tea shop is running by a dominant community, they'll give a separate tumbler to the upper caste people, and sometimes use-and-throw tumbler or separate tumbler to the marginalized community. Another problem is fetching of water. They are not permitted to take water in the common well. And the dominant community never allows the marginalized people to take water in the common well. Third important problem is discrimination in education institutions. Still many schools in rural areas, the dominant community, they are discriminating teachers as well as the students in the education institutions. We have seen number of case studies how students are discriminated in educational institutions. They are forced to do services. Still in the country, after 75 years, still we have manual scavengers, and they are forced to clean the street as well as the area. And they are willing to go for some other job, alternative job, but the dominant community forced them to do the particular job. Denial of services is very common in rural areas, and in saloon, they won't give haircut to the marginalized people. They did not, and even in the public utility services also denied in the rural areas. Interdining is impossible. Sometimes they are discriminated even in the common dining also. Sometimes, if there is a caste problem, caste conflict, the dominant community damaged to the prophet. If they are physically abusing, means sometimes they can come out from their problem. But if they damage the property of marginalized, means it takes a lot of years to build their house. So this is one of the biggest human rights violations among the marginalized. As I have already mentioned, the temple entry, still in some of the places, the marginalized people are denied to enter into the temple. And if there is a common temple, only dominant community people can do all the pujas, and they can do all the worship, and they have to, the marginalized people, they have to wait outside. At the same time, they are not permitted to enter into any place of worship. In some villages, if dominant community or the marginalized people are living in the same village, means the dominant community build a big wall because they don't want to see the oppressed people or marginalized people. We have number of example of this partition wall, especially in Tamil Nadu. And most of the political parties, they involved, and they have broken all this wall. And some of the villages, still they have a restriction. They cannot carry their dead bodies in the common path. Sometimes police has to interfere, and they have to do all these processions. So this is one of the biggest human rights violations in the country. Sometimes the housing discrimination is very common in urban areas. Even some houses, they won't permit marginalized and minorities people. And sometimes the upper caste Hindus, they won't permit the marginalized people or Dalits or Muslim into for the housing. This is very common. The SCs and STs and minorities are facing a number of violence. National Crime Record Bureau, every year they are releasing a report. They clearly mention the number of violences faced by scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and minorities in the country. Sometimes, apart from these marginalized, one among the marginalized community are different disabled people. In all over the world, their basic rights are denied, even in education and employment. Even no company is willing to give a job opportunities to the different disabled. We have to make our research project to focus for the upliftment of the different people, differently abled people also. Other biggest, the marginalized group are transgenders. Still, we have a social stigma towards the transgender people, and they are totally discriminated from the society. Every day, they are facing a number of challenges, especially related to the rights and recognition. And most of the transgenders in India, they are doing begging and sexual, and they are not given education as well as employment opportunities. Sometimes they are facing a physical and sexual abuse by the people in the society. So they are one among the marginalized communities. Another marginalized communities are women. And all the developing women in all over the world, they are facing a number of rights-based issues. In most of the countries, especially in the developing countries, they are not aware of their rights. Sometimes the age of marriage extends to illiteracy and role in the family. Sometimes they have to do a dual role, and child marriage is also possible in some countries. And they are not getting their basic rights in most of the developing countries. And always the male are dominant in the society, and they are totally exploited in all, especially in employment. Even they are not getting equal wages for the work, and the health is also denied. There are a number of hazards related to the attitude and society. Sometimes the society is seeing them the stereotypical attitude towards women on their perceived roles. Especially in India, male is a dominant. Always women, they don't have the rights to express their voice even in the family as well as the society. They are discriminated for their family as well as the society, and they are not considered or consulted in any decision making, both in the family as well as in the society. There are a number of different levels. One is the social level. That is, the social level reflects inadequate social cohesion of integration. Second one is the individual level. That means incapacity to participate in normatively expected social activities and to build a meaningful social relationship. These two levels need to think and do in a project. As we, the social worker, we have to intervene in all these human rights violations, and we have to ensure the human rights of each and every individual, because the social workers are human rights workers. We have to develop a human rights approach on social work education that we can help to provide the empowerment to the marginalized community. And we can do the advocacy work and direct services for the community for their development. And as social work practitioners, we can do a transformation in terms of empathy into action. And we can integrate the norms, the principles, standards, and goals of the international human rights system into plans and process of development. We can make a formation of inclusive society. The social excluded should be included in the society. And we can do all this social inclusion in marginalized people, whether they are women or children, youth, transgender, age, or migrant workers. We have to make a redressal system, the grievance redressal system. We have to change our mindset. We, the social worker, we have to create a change. And constitutional mandate is very, very important. We need to insist the government to implement the laws properly. Even though we have laws, people be escaped through the courts. The good governance is very much necessary, because through the good governance only we can possible to make a transformation. And the equitable allocation of resources to all the people is also very much important, and this should reach all the section of the society. Inclusive growth of sustainable growth, yes, definitely, if we make them to be part of the mainstream community, automatically the sustainable growth is possible. And provide them opportunities at the same time in terms of education or employment or health or infrastructure is also very much necessary. Public-private partnership in development is also one of the important things. Sometimes the social worker can associate with some private partnership for the development of the marginalized community. So empowerment through education, we have to create awareness among the people about the significance of education. And the dream of utopian concept, that means ideal community, is possible through our social work intervention. We have a number of roles of the public. We have to educate people. We have to talk about the problem. We have to ensure tolerant people. We have to make the public to be open-minded, and we have to make them accept the differences among the community. We have to break the stereotypes among the public. We have to try to make friends with the people who have some problems. We have to treat every person equally, and the public need to change the point of view towards the society. United Nations organizations has developed a sustainable development goals. Earlier we had a Millennium Development Goals up to 2015, but 2015 to 2030, we have a sustainable development goals. Our projects, our research should focus to fulfill the need of this sustainable development goals. Because the key theme area of the sustainable development goal is transforming our world. So that is the key agenda of the SDG. We have 17 global goals and 169 targets, and there are 193 members of this UN world. So this SDG is possible all over the world. If you want to make any projects, we have to think about to reach the transforming the world. So far we have discussed the human rights, the social worker interventions, and the redressal mechanism. Coming to the research project, yes, after hearing all these human rights based issues, how can we convert into a research project? We have to make our research project to focus on four important things. The first one is the governance. Governance in terms of administrations and in terms of how to implement it in a systematic and scientific way. Second thing is, when we are doing a human rights based project, the advocacy play a vital role. Third important thing is utilize the resources, utilize the capacity in a proper way. Fourth one is our research should develop facts or knowledge. There are four P's are very important. One is protect, promote, people, and prevent. Protect means protect the people, protect the marginalized. Wherever a human rights violation happens, we have to protect such people. Our project, our research should help to protect from the human rights violation. And we need to promote the people. Empowerment is very, very important. Third thing is we have to develop the people also in all the ways, education, employment. The last one is prevent crimes against the marginalized. These are the phases of our research project. We have initiation phase, a planning phase. In the initiation phase, we have to define our project very clearly. And we need to find out the constraints and the problems. And identification of a research problem is very, very important. As being the social worker, we have number of problems facing in the community. And we have a number of target people in the society also. So we have to identify the problem. Your research problem should be a need-based research problem. And you have to identify the situation, identify the problem of the people. So based on that, you need to develop your research problem. In the planning phase, you have to make a framework of your research project. That means you have to prepare a schedule. At the same time, you have to prepare the estimation of your research project. Third one is execution phase. You have to appoint your project team, whoever is directly or indirectly helping. You need to find out the suitable available resources, and you have to focus the development and management of your research project. After completion of your project, you will get a result. That is your outcome. Afterwards, you need to just monitor whether you have made it possible, and you need to close the project. That is, you have to close the project with your proper outcome. In a research project management, three important things we need to focus. One is assessment, policy development, and assurance. When we talk about assessment, we have to monitor all our projects. The same time, we have to investigate also. Sometimes when you are framing your research questions, this should be based on your experience. At the same time, you have to understand the real problem of the people. The policy development, you need to educate, we have to mobilize, and we have to prepare the policy planning. The assurances, we have to enforce. For example, if you are your results give some suggestions or recommendation, means is it possible to implement it? And if you are recommending some suggestions, whether we have to insist the government implement it. And you need to assure your problem is solved in the society. In the research project management, yes, as we have already mentioned, that you start with understanding your problem. Second one is you have to make a clear plan, that is your research plan. In the research plan, you can just decide all your methodologies, how you are going to do your research, what are the modalities, what are the, whether it is feasible to conduct, whether it is feasible to implement it. Third one is you need to prepare your research design. Fourth one is you have to implement it. And finally, you have to conclude your research project. When you are applying your research project to the funding agency, you need to get the fund. Because when you are applying your fund for funding, you are focusing to get the fund from the funding agency. But the funding agency will receive a number of research proposals, but they will just choose a best one. So you have to make your research project a possible as a feasible one. The same time is your estimation is also very much important for your research project. Before you begin to write your proposal, you have to keep some of the important points. First one is you have to find out the funding sources, whether it is a national or international level. There are a number of funding agencies in local, national, as well as international agencies. Each funding agencies, they have a separate framework as well as the format of research proposal. You must aware of the format of the research proposal of the respective funding agency. Second important thing is your project should be practical, not too costly. Sometimes if the funding agency is willing to give a funding for your research project, your budget should be actual budget. You should not exaggerate, or you should not make your budget more than the practical. Third important thing is the integrated approaches to a development project is very, very important. The funding agency will give a fund to innovative and integrated project only. Fourth important thing is you have to make a proposal, a proper proposal format of a particular funding agency. Next one is find out the budgeting cycle of the agency, whether it is annual or quarterly or ongoing. Sometimes when you are applying for the funding agency, funding agency, they will ask about the duration of your research project. You need to be very clear about whether it is annual based or quarterly based or ongoing, and apply the research project before the deadline. That is very, very important. But funding agency never encourage the research project after the closing date. In your research project, you must have, these are the some of the important elements for your best project management. A proper communication, a proper teamwork, need to have a proper analysis, a proper budget, a proper planning, and problem solving your problem. And you can have a different milestone of your project. You can have a monitoring system to control your project. And you need to know your risk or the challenges of your project. And you must be very clear about the goals, and the time frame of the deadlines are very, very important in any research project management. When you want to make your research project the best one, means you should have a creativity. In the beginning, we discussed the creative ideas will help the social workers to make a wonder in the research project. You should have an innovation. And inspiration is also very, very important. You need to be very much focused on the problem. be specific on your problem. A teamwork is also very much important. If it is possible, you can associate with some other organization or some other agencies, whether it is a government or non-government agencies. That teamwork will help to make your research project a positive. Education, that means you must be aware of the project. You must have a knowledge on your problem of the project. You need to have a self-motivation. At the same time, if number of persons involved in the project means, you have to motivate them to make it possible. Training is very, very important. If you are appointing a field workers or field researchers, a proper training need to be given. Goals and vision, yes, based on the goals and vision only, you can make your project a success one. The 5 E's are very, very important for sustainable development. If you convert all your human rights-based issues into research projects, these 5 E's is helpful for a sustainable development of people. One is education. Our projects can be part of any education, and based on employment, sometimes it based on equality, equity, and empowerment. If the 5 E's are possible, we can make our dream come true. We are human beings. We have right inherent. We have dignity and worth.
Brother, you have to cut the audio of one.
Dignity and worth that exist prior to law. We have crossed 4,700 years of agriculture and animal husbandry era. We have crossed 250 years of industrial era. We have crossed 45 years of information technology era. We have crossed 10 years of digital era. Yes, in the society, the marginalized people are losing their basic rights. Yes, your project need to break the silence and empower the oppressed people to address the future for a sustainable development. While most are dreaming to solve social problems, but we, the social worker, can move ahead and work to achieve it. Future of our nation is on our hand, but we can't wait till the future. We should start our journey from today onwards. If you light a lamp for someone else, it also brightens your own path. In the whole world, education is commercialized, commerce is vulgarized, religion is politicized, politics is criminalized. Women are commodified, children are laborized, and the society is scandalous. Yes, we, the social worker, we have to make a lot of transformation in the society. If we can dream it, we can do it. Life is not about finding yourself. Life is about creating yourself. The happiness of our life depends on the quality of our thoughts. The thoughts won't work unless we do. Yes, we, the social worker, we have to accept our past without regret. We have to handle our present with confidence, and we have to face our future without fear. If we can do it, if we can dream it, we can do it. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Arul Kamaraj. It's a really fantastic presentation. about the whole way of understanding the world, how to look at the world, how to look at our own commitment, change. That's the catchword, transformation. People are looking into our project. What is the social change you want to bring in? I think you brought it very well. And today, every agency wants to see whether you are covering the rights-based. The church is using the same rights-based approach, the words of rights. What is the right that you are touching on? Today, we have a right to health, RTW, RTH, RTF, RTE, that means right to education, right to health, right to work, right to rights of the minorities, rights of the Adivasi. So it's actually rights. It is not health. It's not help. It's a charity. No, it's going beyond, because every man, a poor man, contributes to the society, to the government, for the sake of the government, welfare of the people, through his tax, through her tax. The poor people pay tax. Rich people, many people don't pay the tax. Therefore, it was olden days were told, rob the rich and feed the poor. Today, rob the poor and feed the rich. This is a very big shift that is taking place now, continue many other countries. So the point is, politicians enter to safeguard their own wealth, but the global mindset is different. Today, the Biden coming against Trump is a symbol of hope that people want to see the change, real change for the people. So therefore, every project is oriented towards what is the change you want to create. Dear friends, if you are able to come out with this particular thing, what is the policy you want to make? What is the concept that you have got? What is the expectation you have got? Then your project should be able to come up with one-page material. You try. Very often, we do a lot of work, but no reporting. There are people who do a lot of reporting, no work. So how to get this merging, the homework? Rights-based approach people should have a lot of homework. We need to know the constitution. We need to know what is really happening in the media. We need to know what is the change that is taking place. More than 100 policies have taken place in the government of India in the past 3 months during the lockdown, but we do not know. So very often we are in the field, but intellectually we are not updated. So therefore, very important. Therefore, the rights-based approach we started, I was in CBC at the time, started in 2004 with an international team. At that time, very, very new at that time. Now 16 years passed. 2006 was on the rights-based approach towards the food security was there. India took up very well, and so many new issues have come up. So therefore, we want to see how to practically it has been implemented. So we have got a Jesuit coming for explaining what is the way. Today, Father Stan is inside because he fought for the rights. He brought the rights. He brought to the rights even to the creation of state. So that's a marvelous thing. Today he's in this jail. That is true. Jesus was in jail. Jesus was crucified. And the prophet John the Baptist was in jail. So therefore, it's a real symbol of social transformation. We need not fear for the failures. So I'm very happy to introduce the Jesuit Calcutta, from Jesuit of Calcutta province, Father Jyoti, a social activist, and more specifically is a food activist. And it's a very good model today after the talk of Professor Kamaraj, how he has implemented. In fact, he is the one who brought the election manifesto of West Bengal because of the food rights. So when that Mamata Banerjee take up the post, he was one of the important invitees because of the food activism. He's the convener of West Bengal State Right to Food Campaign and the member of National Right to Food Campaign. Former member of Vigilance and Monitoring Committee of Food-Related Issues in two districts of West Bengal. Till recently, he was the Social Action Coordinator of Calcutta Jesuits and the Province Developmental Director, so he's the right person. He has taken up food-related issues in different international forums, such as Global Food Rights Movement, and networked with the international agencies on food-related issues in the United Nations in Geneva. So we are very happy to have Reverend Father Jyoti, presently is the director of the Dhyan Ashram Retreat House and also the administrator of Jesuit Formation House, Kolkata. He's a member of many rights activist groups in West Bengal. There are so many other things to see. So I'm very happy to invite Father Jyoti. The floor is yours. I think he wants to say something also about first time, who has been an activist on this particular day. Welcome, Father Jyoti. The floor is yours.
Thank you.
One needs to be off my mobile, yes.
Yeah, I think, Father, you are using two instruments. Cut the volume and mic.
Dear friends, at 7:30, we'll be concluding this. There will be a lot of questions. After 7:30, still the questions can be asked, Father, both for Dr. Kamaraj and for Jyoti. Welcome, Father Jyoti.
Am I audible now?
Yes, Father.
Okay, thank you very much. I got the information that around 11 countries people are participating, fathers, sisters, and friends. And before I start, I just want to keep a minute of silence in solidarity with Father Stan Swami. Just before those who don't know who the Father Stan Swami is, one of the Jesuits, 84 years, nearly 83 years old, 84 years old now. He is not well. He has got a Parkinson's disease, but all his life he had been fighting for the rights of the Dalits and Adivasi. As a result, the fascist government we have in India right now arrested him for a flimsy ground and put him in the jail very far away from where he is working. He is in Mumbai, in the jail now around 40 days already. So just a minute silent. We who want to be the rights activist will, in solidarity with this Stan and his companion, 16 of them, for no reason they are there. Let's pray to the Lord for strength and comfort for them. Thank you very much. At the very initial phase, I just wanted to thank Father Nitya and his team for organizing this workshop. I want to especially thank him because he is the one who introduced to me this rights-based approach way back in 2006, as you said, when it was very hot discussion, we didn't know what it was. So we were getting into that. And I was just a young priest. I'm a missionary, a Jesuit, all the way from South India, working in the eastern part of India, in West Bengal. I was just thrown into the field. So what I'm going to do after hearing from Dr. We had a Dr. Kamaraj, a beautiful presentation. I want to give you a story, the story of what, how I done it, and what is a possibility of implementing the Right to Food campaign in our own way. It is possible. Some of us are already engaged. And we have to be engaging in this rights-based approach on behalf of the specially optioned people or the preferentially optioned people for our life. As religious, as priests, we have to stand for them. And therefore, we need to apply this right to food because we are not alternative to the duty bearer, that is the government or administration. We should clearly make sure that we are not an alternative to the government. The government has got the money power and manpower. They can do much more far-reaching impact. And we have done it. We have done it. I will share you that story. So let me get back to you. The starting of 2005, 3 to 5, that's the time I got into the field. I was a young missionary entering into the field without knowing the language and the people and their culture and systems, slowly trying to learn. And there is always a suspicion among the people, this missionary, you know, by language, by color, I am different from them. So they were suspecting this guy has come for conversion. Correct? I had a big baggage of being a missionary who was a converting. But in fact, I went, suggested to them, before I starting talking to them, I said, just in general conversation, I was talking, we are going to teach the children, your children, because the children were having some mother tongue, which is not being taught in that language in the local villages, which is a different language they've been taught. The children were not able to grasp it. So up to class 4, they were just passed without even, you know, registering whether they are taught or not taught, a single teacher teaching 4 classes and so on. So what we said, we will coach them whatever they do in the school. That's the starting point. As a kind of coaching center, we started. The children's where we were regularly meeting. To coach these children, I took some young volunteers from the villages, paid them simple, small amount. And I started talking to these volunteers regularly, connect them together and talking to them various issues of the villages. Then we said, we want to have a meeting in your villages. So these tribal villages have got a system called Maji Adam, the 5 leaders. So they make a clear decision of how they have to reach. So when I sat with them and they accepted to sit with us for a meeting, I sat with them and I started in a different way, analyzing the society, analyzing the village, analyzing their own life. And I brought into the point that this is a dying generation. You are a dying generation if you don't wake up right now. That's the point I was trying to stress into, because that was the thing I found. A small study I conducted and found out the life expectancy was 45 to 50 years. That's it. That was shocking. So I told them, this is what it is. Look at the other places, how the people are developing. And so that hit them. So my engagement with the children expanded to their mothers. So as the saying goes, if you want to hold the heart of a mother, hold the hand of the child. So that was the strategy. We held the hand of the child and touched the heart of the mother. So we got the mothers connected together again, the children's mother. And we had a discussion with them. So what do you want to do with the children? What do you want to do with their parents? Most of these mothers were young mothers. Some of them were single mothers, are 25, 30 years old, you know. So there's a very powerful resource groups. Most of them are not educated, not visited to school. So I started discussing, what will be your future? Do you want to come together? Do you want to spend time together? Do you want to analyze yourself something together? They said, yes, that's it. Okay, we visualize to have a kind of movement for them. That's the time it was self-help groups, self-finance, like a small financing unit started. We introduced that to the villages and they picked it up. Then that's the time the Indian government came out with a legislation called National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005. We said, by which act, every willing individual will get 100 days of work if they apply for it. I said, very good. I am working with those really disadvantaged group, Dalit and Adivasi women, especially more disadvantaged, more exploited about this group. So we said they need work. They are all laborers or agricultural laborers or at home laborers only. So we said, we want that work. We will apply for it. But we realized that was the time a particular government was completely controlling this particular part of the state. So we could not break in. And immediately after that, there was another legislation came called the Right to Information. I said, okay. Having listened and learned about the rights-based approach, we just wanted to apply that. And when we went to the government offices with the application, this is what the right to information, they said, ja, means get lost. We don't need you. We don't believe in all these things, they said. That's kind of humiliation we had it. Anyway, we came, we worked again. We wanted to go ahead and again work on that. Now, what happened? We started telling the people, that's the time we were also introduced by the the CBCI, Justice and Peace Commission, headed by Father Nitya and the team, they introduced to us, what is the Supreme Court law, Supreme Court order on the food-related issues. Okay, we said, very good, beautiful. That was the Supreme, why Supreme Court came with an order, because there is a kind of a precedence. In 2001, in India, there was a lot of starvation at one side. On the other side, a lot of food grains getting rotten. Somebody filed a case in the Supreme Court. It's called the PIL, Public Interest Litigation. And the Supreme Court, for our surprise, had taken up seriously and pulled up the state governments. Come on, tell us what you're doing. And the government was embarrassed. The federal type of government got embarrassed. So they have to give something. So they went around saying that, oh, we do this for the pregnant woman, this we do for this one for the children, this for the students, this for the aged, this for the young. So many things they said. Government, Supreme Court listened to everything. Beautiful, you are narrating very well. And they know that it's not true. They said, from now on, you will do it. Supreme Court came with the rules, order. Okay, we built on it. immediately the Supreme Court also appointed, each state will have one representative who will advise the Supreme Court. So ordinary village powerful person have been appointed, village are, you know, movement leaders. So when they came, and I, one of the trainings I organized in 2005 or 6, I said, we need something more about. So we got the Supreme Court advisor to come and give us an knowledge on that, education on this. This particular lady came, very generous, very willing. She explained, okay, if you are really interested, come and join us. So beautiful. We were just, that time we were having a few hundred women organized, maybe 200, 300, maybe 500 women organized. We said, we will go and work with them, collaborate with them. Before the Jesuits, we started talking about networking collaboration. We already started because there was a need. Why there was a need? When I went to the villages, they were saying that this guy is a missionary. He's come for conversion. But I'm talking about rights, their food rights, their education rights, their work rights. But it wasn't very well, you know, it twisted immediately. You know, the same guys come, even missionaries will come with a twist, kind of misunderstanding was there. Well, that was a challenge. I took it up and immediately collaborated with the Supreme Court advisor. That was a beautiful and a secular phase that we had with that. What happened after that? So we organized one day a protest called Tala Kulo Abhijan. Tala Kulo Abhijan means open the locks of the food gates of the godown where you got a food stacked there, the rice godown. So we said, we will take the women whom we have organized a few hundred, go in a procession, Thala Kulo Kava Dao, Kava Chai Kava Dao. That's the kind of slogans we will shout and go. And in front of that office, we will stop and give a deputation saying that we need food, we are hungry and starving and all that kind of things, which is very embarrassing to the government. So this is the name and shame of the strategy we used it. We went to the people and said, and with the real people who are really hungry, some of the widows, single mothers and all, we go with them, say, we don't have any ration card, nothing is there, please give them. It is more political. Okay. Political, we don't have any party politics. No. When you are talking about rights, you are taking a political stand. And because you are, as a citizen, you have the right. And so you're asking the right. It is impossible for us, and only we can do it. So when we did this, people started listening to us. And that time in West Bengal, we only had two, three political, major political parties taking procession. We were something out of, you know, the context. We were something, they were asking which party, gone wrong, which color are you? He said, we don't have any color, so we have got a food color. So even the rickshaw pullers and others also easily joined us because this is something nice to hear. So it was a good success. What happened? The women who came in a big protest demanding thing, akon tala kulo, now open the door and give them food. They really believed that. And they had a lot of courage looking at me, and I had a lot of courage looking at them. So it was a beautifully kind of supporting each other. And from then on, we started building. Okay, that's 2008-09. Then we said, this government's now taking it as, you know, like a great benevolence. Out of their generosity, they are going to give. We said, no, food is our basic rights. India is a signatory to the international treaties, and therefore they have to listen to this. So we said from the grassroots, not only we, means only the Jesuit group, no, along with the other network partners, we said we will demand for a legislation, a law for the food. Okay, that started 2008 onwards. Where do we go and ask for it? We cannot just shout in our villages. We have to strategically go. So we take the women and men to the government administration in the capital, Calcutta. Then we said, policymakers are not in Calcutta. It is a central government. It's a federal government where somebody else takes the policy. Somebody takes the decision to make the law. So we should go there. So we have to go to the national capital, go to Delhi. So you will be surprised. In the last 10 years, maybe 20, 25 times, I took women and men to Delhi in the train, 100 of them, 100, 200 sometimes we have taken, sometimes 300 we have taken from here to other state, Ranchi, Jharkhand state. We had so many protests and movements. Of course, when we go to so many of them in the train, you will be asking, where did I get the money to pay so much of, you know, like tickets? Suddenly we cannot afford to do it. And because the people, that's one of the protests again. We want to register protest saying that we don't have our money to pay for our ticket. So we take one of the passengers that goes and we occupy two compartments. all of us sit together and make a slogan, some play cards, and then we go to reach Delhi after 2 days. So 2 days, 3 days, sometimes we sit and go, sometimes we stand and go, sometimes it's like that, crowded. So, but we go in the Delhi, then from Delhi, we had some Gurudwara to where we accommodated and we were given food and so on. Anyway, so like this, many times we went, then we felt when we are having, when do we have a system? We have to have a strategy. When the parliament in session, we used to have our protest in Jantar Mantar. Okay. Now, once and twice we saw nobody coming to meet us. We are hundreds of them, thousands of them from all over India. We have come. Nobody comes to meet us. So what we said, we will go and meet them. So we went a small group, went to the where the MPs have got their own hostels. We go there and meet them and gave them our deputations. We tell them, don't pass this bill or pass the bill. So we have given demands. This is the way lobbying and canvassing was going on. What one group we've had managed to bring that the MPs and different political party representatives to our team, and they had a they addressed us and so on, they promised. So basically the opposition party in support of all these kind of policies, so we pushed into them at times. You know, this present government also was in opposition, so we had to go through them also sometimes. But it was we were very politely, we knew what their strategy, so we didn't too much entertain them. Their promises, we didn't accept everything. We didn't believe in their promises, but anyway, we needed their strength also. Anyway, so we had such amount of strategy. We went in and out because this is a need. In 2013, there was some bill they brought in, right to food bill they brought in. We opposed it because we demanded something else, what the government was might little. We wanted change. What we did was postcard campaign. We sent 2 lakhs of postcards, that's 200,000 postcards from West Bengal alone to this food minister. And it was acknowledged by the food minister, then food minister, Chidambaram. He said in the parliament, House of Parliament, only from West Bengal we got 2 lakhs letters. I have to read through before I pass the bill. I placed the bill in the parliament. So it was like that strategy. We have to use a strategy. So we used a lot of strategies, often demonstration in the villages and protest and so on was going on. We managed to get a law, though less than what we expected, in 2013. It's called the National Food Security Act. Once law is done, it's more work for us. Because the government has got any amount of legislation for the poor people, but the implementation is poor, and that is where we need to work. We are not saying anything else to the government. We are saying, government, please follow the law. You have made a law. Obey the law. If you are not obeying, your place is not sitting there. You should be also in the jail. That we have said it. We have said it to the government officials. We need to say that. They have to know that they have to follow the law. And we are in favor of the, in, with the side with the poor. And therefore, we need to take our bold step and courageously we should go and move ahead with this. We did it. We felt successful many times. And the very many protests brought in a lot of courage to our women. The women who are basically this Adivasi and Dalit women who are housebound, only cooking and no vision. Now I can boldly say that in wherever we are working, they have started forming an organization. Now they have got 5 NGOs organized themselves. They made it a big movement. They connected themselves with other network partners. In this kind of rights space, we cannot have a single people working. We need to work a collaboration. Collaboration, networking, the word for this. And without that, we cannot do much. And since we have got a tag of all this kind of, you know, name easily, even now the people know that I'm a missionary, but they know that I am not coming up for only conversion. Okay, they understand me. I'm fighting with many other like-minded people for the rights of the people. Yes, it is possible. And this is the reason for the stand Swami today is in jail, because he stood for the Adivasis' rights, their Jal Jamin jungle, land, water, and forest rights. And that right is not only he was demanding it, that was government made it legislation. He was telling that government made legislation, you follow the law, tell the people that you have a law, you have the right over this. That's what he was telling. And that are the people, these are the people, dangerous people. And therefore you have a challenge. Okay, you have a challenge. You will have a challenge when you are faced. Of course, I also had some, you know, the IB, the Information Bureau from central government and the state government, CIDs and all, they will be coming, torturing. They'll be asking a few questions and always they'll be nagging. This will be a necessary evil. You will have to face it. You will get stronger and grow more stronger by looking at the people with whom you are standing. They are with you. They need you and they will be. there will be a kind of transformation taking place. The more and more people started demanding themselves for their rights, government has cheated. One example I'll give you during this lockdown time. There were a West Bengal government gave a free ration because central government gave it to some people. There are one particular group of cardholders, one nearly 1.4 crore, that is 140 million people, maybe. I think that's how it is called. I think 140 million people were not given food. So we said that's a huge group. We have to give. Many NGOs, religious and other groups started giving them food. Very good. You feel good factor, no problem. You could reach out to so many people. How much maximum would give? A few hundred crore maybe? 100 crore, 200 crore we can give? All the NGOs put together in the state. What we did was a different strategy. We said, okay, we also did something. We also felt nice. Very good. Now we said, we will do something else. Government had issued, gave some few numbers. You know, it's a crisis number. When you got somebody stranded, you can go there. Some corona things have happened, you can inform them. We made use of all that. Didi ke bolo, various other phone call they gave, various other nodal offices they had. Everywhere we went with the food demand. We need food. We are not given food and so on. So the government had to respond to us. And therefore, government decided this 150 million people were also included free ration. Imagine if that was the thing. We had a small calculation to find out how much we have received. If we are paid, the government had paid, see, 2000 per month, 2040 million Indian rupees, 2000, that is more than 204 crore per month. So last 5-6 months, they have been paying that to this particular group, not to the whole group. This particular group, they are paying it 204 crores. So last 8 months, imagine how much we have got. Such an amount of money, we could not do it. Rights-based, a simple calculation. On the day lockdown started, we started having conference calls. Mobile phone conference calls. Regularly, we used to have. Make use of all the system and method. Used to Twitter, used to Twitter storms, used to Facebooks and various other places, said people are dying, starving. Friends, right now we are having a hunger studying in India. Right Food campaign, we are having it. West Bengal, we are reaching out to 3,000 people, candidates. We want to check whether they are hungry or not. Whether things are going to come out in a month or two, we are going to come out with this press statement and various other things. As we are talking, on 22nd, we are having a national call of action day. Various levels, we will be doing it. And small groups will go do a demonstration of starving people and post this. People are still starving. Why the central government has decided to stop, wind up this free ration by November, this month? What will happen? Next month, there's going to be a starvation. Next month onwards, people have nothing to eat now. Many of them are really demanding, waiting for this free ration. They are not going to get, there's going to be major starvation deaths. So friends, which we need, we are waking it up. We will have a challenge, but challenge is part of life. We should go ahead. Our prophet, as was said, Father Nitya said it, you know, the prophet John the Baptist had to give his head. Jesus has to give his life. He's murdered on the cross. You and me are called to be a prophet today in the modern world. We have a set of already examples, even in our India, few martyrs we have. We got to now Blessed Maria, Sister Maria. And we have got A.T. Thomas, and we have got Valsal John. These are all people who stood for the rights of the people, and they given their life for that. Friends, when the other activists, some of them are saying it, we are living in a very dangerous time, and we have to be clear. Days are going to be much more dangerous for us. We cannot shy away or hide ourselves. They are going to come after us. Whether we should take a lead and stand on behalf of the poor, Dalit and Adivasi, migrants and minorities of our country. And come what may, life is once, we shall give it up. We can be a prophetic voice to the people, and we have to be a prophetic voice to the people. We can never change the government. We can never be alternative to government. We have to be the voice of the people against the violation of law by the government. Get them the rights we want. So that's been my experience. And it's a very fulfilling experience, my dear brothers and sisters. Very fulfilling. The poor people, when you look at you, they get energy. When you look at them, you feel the sense of your vocation there. When you say Jindabad, Jindabad, there is Jesus living and shouting. That's by my experience of it. So friends, it is not a rights-based approach. It's not a theory, impossible one. No, very much possible, very much an invitation for you and me to be a rights-based activist today. Face like a challenge, maybe like a stand, but I think we are Jesuits. We are sometimes proud. Actually, we are proud that we could be in the galaxy of so many activists who are in the jail. We also have one representative there. Maybe tomorrow you and me can be part of it. All the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Father Jyoti. Actually, dear friends, we are just on time now, but there will be time for some questions and clarifications. And some have not attended this in the first part, but all thing will be given to you in the video message tomorrow morning. Tomorrow by noon, it will be ready. Okay. Just I want to add something. The CBCA, when I was working, we covered 15 states and we prepared this material. This is actually what I am showing you is the video. This is a video, a digital material, Right to Food campaign. We prepared this and there's a material, all the materials in 12 languages, 12, 13 languages translated. And this has been a small booklet which can be put inside. All the rights and duties and duty bearers. Duty bearers means the government, what the government has to do and what we can claim, claim holders. This is actually the methodology, right to vote. It's a non-violent approach. It's based on rules and regulation. It's based on constitutional rights. So all that Professor Kamrai said was very important thing. And we can go, it's a faith-based approach. It's also connected to our faith. So this particular booklet has got all the very simple language which people can do. This has been translated also in many languages, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu, Oriya, all these languages. And again, that will be translated to small booklet, leaflet. This is a leaflet. Each has got a particular thing for a different rules, 10 points. We made it to 10 commandments. So these are the things which we can utilize always, whatever you do. You come up with this kind of things, your projects will be valued. Your proposal will be valued. What is the thing that you want to do? We have made ration card alone 128,000. There will be 1,28,000 ration cards we have regularized in 15 states through this CBCA when I was in the Justice Service Commission. And so many networks we created, so many networks, different religious congregations also collaborated, diocesan directors collaborated. Go on giving training, motivate them, giving them new information, rules and regulation, changes. All these things give them power to say. When you want to go and meet the collector, you should quote the number. So homework is very important. Even in your own province, if you go to the chapter decrees, there are a lot of things to do here with the poor people, the marginalized people. Actually, remember all the schools, all the educational things, all the medical things, they all come under the social welfare. Your congregation, all our congregations are having the topmost thing is care for the poor, the cry of the poor. The social apostolate is the thing. But the pity is today we are taken to a school running activities, hospital institution running activities, but the social workers are sidelined. Most of your exorbitantly clever people are there among you, very committed people, but you have made a big sacrifice for coming into social activities. This is a marvelous thing. At the end of the world, at the end of your life, you will be able to say that you created some change in the society. This is actually what is true. We are always ready to help you for any number of people. We have got some nice teamwork for projects. Be clear about what is the goal. What is your purpose? Remember, your society is standing for the cry of the poor and the change of the society. That is why the founder had a dream. All our congregations have got founder's dream, which is always connected to the poor people. The cry of the girl children, the cry of the widows. So many things are there. Therefore, the rights-based approach means your own right of your own congregation. So therefore, in your congregation, when your chapter comes, be bold to speak out. This is the thing. Quote the number of the constitution. I've trained so many people. The Jyoti is one example. He has gone up to the changing the policies in the parliament. And the Colin Gonzalez, who created this fight against the government officially, he won the case and brought this right to food campaign. He said, this particular method has been very effective. Therefore, sisters and brothers, you have the power. You have the power. And we are with you. We are all together. There are more than 200 people. All our organizations, all our meetings were 400, 500. But today, this is the lowest one, 250. less than 250. This is very, very strange for us. And we have brought the excellent team. This is a very good team we have brought. And tomorrow we are going to have on the fundraising. Fundraising, not that money is the base, but the people is the base. So how to raise the fund, on what basis, and what base you are going to monitor, what the base you are going to report, what the daily report, weekly report, monthly report, all these things are part and parcel of our progress. Then we'll be followed by the FCRA, FCR rules and regulations in connection with the NGOs. If your provincials, if your financial administrators are there, ask them to come and participate. Don't worry about the money. They don't need to pay. Let them know, at least let them know. Even if there's your congregation, some people are really involved in it, just ask them to enter inside. You're not bothering about the payment. Let them know what's really happening so that you'll be having that there's a teamwork for you. And at the end, we'll also come to know what the church stands for, what your congregation stands for with the marginalized. Therefore, I thank both Dr. Kamaraj, Arul Kamaraj, and also Father Jyoti. You know, Jesuits know they are committed to one particular thing till the end they'll go. For us poor Capuchins and some of you, 3 years of social, 3 years of school work, 3 years of novice mistress. So this is a very painful thing, but we are undergoing. But still, God is with us. God is with our work. Therefore, I think Father Jyoti wants to share a small video clip, some 3 minutes. You can go through that. If there's any question, they are ready to answer also. Thank you so much. Father Ben, can you come online? Father Ben is our host, and we are thanking him actually. He's the one who is going to guide us now. Thank you, Father Ben. Yes, thank you, Father Jyoti. Thank you, Father Kamaraj.
Thanks, sir.
It's a small video, 4 minutes.
তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না, শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না। তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না, শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না। তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না, ইসু পাল্টাতে পাল্টাতে শিখি, আর শিখতে শিখতে পাল্টাই। পাল্টা স্রোতে ভেসে গিয়ে দিন বদলের গান গাই। কেউ দল পাল্টায়, কেউ ভুল পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় যুক্তি তর্ক। নাম ধাম পাল্টায়, দরদাম পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় কত সম্পর্ক। রাজনীতি পাল্টায়, দুর্নীতি পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় মুখ আর মুখোশের রং। দিন পাল্টিয়ে রাত পাল্টায়, জাতপাত পাল্টায়, ধর্মে রং বংচং। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। এসো পাল্টাতে পাল্টাতে শিখি, আর শিখতে শিখতে পাল্টাই। পাল্টা স্রোতে ভেসে গিয়ে দিন বদলের গান গাই। ধূসাধুনি পাল্টায়, বিকিনি পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় শেয়ারের দর। সকালটা পাল্টায়, বিকালটা পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় রাতের শহর। দিনক্ষণ পাল্টায়, মাসক্ষণ পাল্টায়, পাল্টায় ক্যালেন্ডার। রাজা আসে, রাজা যায়, লাল নীল জামা গায়, পাল্টায় রং ঝান্ডার। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। শুধু সমাজটা পাল্টায় না, তাই জীবনটা পাল্টায় না। পাল্টাতে পাল্টাতে শিখি, আর শিখতে শিখতে পাল্টাই। পাল্টা স্রোতে ভেসে গিয়ে দিন বদলের গান গা।
স্বাধীন হয়েছে রে স্বাধীন, তাই কিন্তু খুশি শাসকের শোষণে, জীবনে ও মরণে আমরা রয়েছি আজ পরাধীন। স্বাধীন হয়েছে রে স্বাধীন, তাই কিন্তু খুশি শাসকের শোষণে, জীবনে ও মরণে আমরা রয়েছি আজ পরাধীন। স্বাধীন হয়েছে দেশ স্বাধীন,
Thank you. I think so.
জীবনে ও মরণে আমরা রয়েছি আজ পরাধি স্বাধীন হয়েছে দেশ আমাদের এই গণতন্ত্র শাসকের হাতে গড়া যন্ত্র আমাদের এই গণতন্ত্র শাসকের হাতে গড়া যন্ত্র আমাদের এই অভিমান সততার কাছে মরাই স্বাধীন হয়েছে দেশ স্বাধীন তাই কি দুঃখ সীমাহি শাসকের শোষণে জীবনে
Yes, Father. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Father Jyoti, for this wonderful expression. How a religious congregation can involve in the secular society and come out with a tangible results. Now I request any of you to ask any questions we have got. Father Ben will like guide us. Father host is Father Ben. If you want, you can raise your hand or you can write your questions in that. Any clarification with regard to anything to do with these issues? You can unmute.
Yeah, you can unmute yourself. So many compliments have come.
Yeah. We'll be sending you the PowerPoint tonight or tomorrow, and along with the video messages. Remember, it is sent on Thalir-Visit. Then Thalir-Visit is the channel. You will get all our motivational speeches, even previous ones also. I think it's wedding time.
You can just unmute and ask.
Yes. There is a question, I think. Claret Bhavan, Father Ben, you can read.
We have already formed the SHG group.
Group.
Next, Father.
Ah. What to do with the self-help groups? Father Jyoti, I think it's asked for both of us. They have formed SHG groups. That is Claret Bhavan. They are asking, what to do after getting the SHG groups?
May I know which part of the country this SHG is formed?
India,
which part? In which state?
Sister Claret Bhavan.
Which state?
Generally, you can say. Generally, okay, I think there.
Okay. Fine. See, you have got central groups right now. There are plenty of all over India. A lot of programs for them. A lot of schemes for them has been given by the central government and these different state governments. Now, that is one way of taking them and empowering them. Certainly, we need to empower them because these self-help groups are basically among the tribals and Adivasi women, and we need to support them, minority women. Second, while doing that, Indian government has got very many schemes and the state government also has come with very many schemes introduced for them. We need to know. Where do we come to know? If it is basically in the block level, you know, administrative block level, we have got all the schemes being explained. You can go to the South India and all much more, online, you can get all the information. Okay, so you can get, pardon, Maharashtra.
Maharashtra.
Claret Bhavan, Maharashtra, yes. Maharashtra, you got very many schemes and you just tip up the things in your block level. What are the schemes that's available? You can check it out. Tell your women's group or train them of these schemes, how to get the schemes, whom to apply to, how to apply, what to demand, because you get all the information from the online, you get it. Teach them, basically with regard to food. Maharashtra, we got a very good network. Right to Food Network, very powerful network they are there. Because a lot of Maharashtra and Saurashtra areas and a lot of starvation going to be in the coming days. So we can connect with them and they will be very happy to get connected with us. That's very important. Many of these Right to Food activists are longing to get more connections. We cannot do it alone, singly. We have to go in a group. Otherwise, they will take a, you know, individually, they will take for a kind of granted that they'll follow us and adopt. So whenever you go together, you have to go in a big number. Bigger the number is the better the impact for them. So you have to find which are the schemes available in that particular part of the state and the village and the block and apply there. If that is not there, go to the district. In the district website, you will have all the schemes coming down. How to approach the scheme? Say, for instance, for the now they are coming with the women, for the children or young girls, there are a lot of schemes coming out. Can you get them out? Unemployed youth are the right now after the COVID. Unemployed youth have got very many entrepreneurship programs are being there. Money is allotted. Can you study and then go and ask the people, women, to say these are the monies available and you have to apply to this and get that money and do it? Small way. Individually they can do or as a group wise they can do. While doing it, basically it's not only a finance program that they're going to discuss. We tell them to build up the society, build up the community, their unity among themselves, and together they can raise the voice. So you already the first base you have done. You have got your foot soldiers now, sisters or brother, whoever that is. You have got your foot soldiers already. Just to motivate them because they know your dedication and they will be with you. They will listen to you. I take hundreds of them, very disciplined people, because they know what we stand for and we don't cheat. And that's what the because ordinary people, the village people have been often cheated. Even the Senthan group, simple money they collect, that's been cheated with them. So you are in a better position. You have built up them, formed them. Form them as a federations. Together we can ask them, mobilize them. I have fielded them in politics, sisters, recently. I have fielded them in politics, forming them. Now they are taking up as an NGO. So you have done a wonderful work already by forming them, several groups. Just build on them of their rights. Inform them what is their rights. For that, you need to know about what is their right. It's all available on the website, sister. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Father Ben, there's a question, I think.
Yes, Father. Johan, FSC, you can speak.
Yeah, I wish to thank the organizers. I am a Rilappan brother working in Sri Lanka, northern part of Sri Lanka. And the entire session was very impressive and I am really, you know, it's very encouraging. The thing is that the majority or most of the issues, matters, or was that all related to India. The Sri Lankan context, I wonder how the timing, the wonderful ideas for Father, I can't get Father Jesuit, Father Ben.
Jodi.
We have a Jesuit also in our neighbor working here. We have your community fathers here. So my question is that how can we implement, how can we practice in our context, because keeping to the our prevalent political, you know, it's very risky and I don't know, that's the only thing that my I just want to comment on that. These are your ideas are wonderful and so we have gone through these 30 years of war and we are in a post-war situation and there are a lot of things we can do. And we are involved in the education of the Mana, that's the northern part of Sri Lanka, very much closer to the South India. So I don't know, in the forthcoming sessions, if you can enlighten or give us some kind of, you know, thoughts how we can implement in our context.
Brother, I just wanted to respond to you. You are raised a very, very important question, pertinent. This food rights is India's special. It has not come from the top to down. From the down, we have a bottom-up approach. Ordinary people, we coined this law. Now, what happened to the others? Brother, we should know that in Nepal, there are some already, they are applying something like that. In Bangladesh, we are helping them to formulate something like that. We want Sri Lanka also to have legislation like that. They don't have a legislation, but you can have a legislation. But you have various schemes on that. We have got some partners in Sri Lanka who are working with fisher folks and their food rights. and various other places. They don't have a legislation as of now, we don't have, but there is work going on. There are other people who are a network, very good people are working, so we can connect to them. The official folks have been organized on the food issues, they are working on it. Besides the food issue, there are very many issues. Education is there, health is there, shelter is there, environment is there, the tea garden workers are there, the affected people of the war are there. So many other, these are all human rights based approach. You can do that, but you just look at it, everything is rights, people's rights. So you, there are people who are working, just we need to connect them to get the base. And for me, as anytime I could get some people to organize this, because we had like self-help groups, and that can also be worked out in your country. Thank you, brother.
Thank you. Thank you.
Shall we wind up, Father Ben? Is it anybody is asking? Divya raised hand, something.
Gracia.
Yes, Father. I'm Sister Divya.
Louder, please.
Yeah, I'm Sister Divya. Hello?
Yes, Sister. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Sister Divya from SD Congregation, St. Mary's Province in Ernakulam. So I have one question, I wish to clear one doubt with Father Jodi.
Yes, Sister, most welcome.
Yeah. Father, thank you for your motivating session. It was really wonderful. We enjoyed a lot. And my doubt is that these days we are working on a research for differently abled people, especially on the basis of this COVID situation. The theme is because during this COVID situation, they suffered a lot. A lot of things are promised by the government and some of them implemented. But these all things, frankly, rejected for these people, for these differently abled people. A lot of them lacking their medicines and it causes for their relapsing. And some of them are suffering about starvation. Most of their parents are unemployed. But government didn't do much things for them. So we wish to highlight these points and invite government's attention to these people. So research is on in the end phase, and we wish to hand over that research, the binding research, to the collector. Actually, we wish to make one policy change. Father, can you give some suggestions how we can make it more effective, or how we can how we can make it more effective? That's my question.
Yeah, I understood. Beautiful. You are doing Ernakulam area, no? You said?
Yeah, Father. Yeah.
Yes, very, very nice.
Probably is in Alve. So we wish to hand over this research to Ernakulam collector.
Okay, very good. As regard to the food situation and the government response to the food, Kerala is one of the best. Okay, they are reaching out, is very, very nice, very well. Your study and input will be a great help for the government to reach out. While you are working on this input, sister, every block, panchayat should have something called the gravity relief. Every panchayat should have some kind of food materials always. They should immediately reach out. That's for our country. So they should apply immediately. Those people who are hungry, I think during the lockdown time, the West Bengal, Kerala government reached out to house to house. That was the news we are getting. If there are some starvation cases, please will bring it out. I think the government is going to respond very, very responsibly in your state. And that need not to be at the top level. We can already, while you're doing the research, you should have somebody, your workers, your animators who are there, you can ask them to reach out to this panchayat level. Panchayat level, those people are supposed to be, because I spoke to some of those panchayat people in Kerala to get some of the migrants back. They were very prompt. I was surprised the way they worked out. You know, therefore, I think Kerala has got one of the best educated administration at the grassroots level itself. So we can tell them they reach out. So, sister, the knowledge that you have got, the cases you have got, just we have to go with the proof. We have to go the exact case. These are the cases. These are the addresses. These are starving. They don't have any food. They need health care. And it has to be a kind of draft. You can make it. put them together and they can go together actually to the panchayat or the block level or administrative district level, they certainly will get a response immediately. The beautiful work that you are doing as a research and the data and the research study will be of great help also for your negotiation with the lobbying with the government. I think this will be they will appreciate it, I think. So it's
May I add one point to what Father Jyoti says, Father Ben? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I would like to add one to our Sister Divya's question. That research is very good, Sister Divya. And one more thing is Right to Information Act. Make use of the Right to Information Act with regard to what is the amount allotted by the government in that particular locality for the physically challenged people or the persons with the disabilities, PWD, person with the disabilities. So this particular amount, where it has gone, how much money has been allotted, who has used it. This will be a very good eye-opener. The government will give the thing and contact RTF commissioner, Right to Food commissioner, or the other social welfare commissioner. They'll be able to give you that particular thing. Will be the best thing to give to the collector. With that, you can go for redress mechanism. Redress mechanism. I think Father Arul Kamaraj has told very clearly about the various things about what all things can be done. This is one of the things is redress mechanism based on Right to Information Act, RTF, RTI. So that will be good for your research also, sister.
One more point I'd like to just. Kamaraj, professor. Thank you so much. Sister, I would like to add one more point regarding your research. When you are doing your research on focus on differently abled people, kindly ensure whether they are given recognitions in education and employment. If possible,
that's also one concerned area for us, Father.
You can just insist your government to give a reservation both in private and public sector also. If you give a reservation in terms of education and employment, definitely you can just make a lot of transformation among the differently abled people. Kindly focus on these rights. This is the basic rights, education and employment. Kindly just include as a recommendations in your research project to the government also.
Yeah, actually, we concentrate on these three basics, education, food, and employment.
Okay, sir.
And sister, another thing,
and
sister.
Father?
One point I want to complete it. What I would do if in your place I was there, I would take a photo of this person. With the Twitter, I will make it and tag the government immediately. See, this is the starvation people, hungry, see their houses, and take the photo and give the address. Tag the people, tag the government officials, collector, and even the PM, the minister, chief minister's office. They will respond. They have done it in our place, experience system. Please do that.
Right. And for one more doubt, and for this is a my strong desire is that to hand over to collector, and kindly I am wish expert hoping that it will be one policy making, but is there any official way to in order to hand over? We just plan to hand over a one bind form of our research. Is it enough, or any other form?
If you want to reach your research project to the government, both the state and the central government, if possible, better you can have a press conference also. Okay, right. Just publish your results in the press so that it will reach every people all over the country. So everybody will aware of that. So that you can make it as a publicize your research project.
That result in how we can present this now?
Yeah, you can just have a press meet and you can just present your findings in the press.